that's one, that's almost one day of pure travel.
I get the back of your eyes here.
Please take note of the events that are taking place. Ladies, there is no Bible study this Tuesday, as your fearless leader is away discovering the world. And they're having a wonderful time as they are sharing and seeing all the beautiful things around the world. So that will not be taking place. But ladies, do remember that the Christmas shoebox program. We are hoping to compile shoeboxes for the Samaritan's Purse ministry. You can see Melissa, you can see Miss Barbara when she's back in town if you have any questions about that. Also, in the front pews, we have the loaves and fishes boxes. This is the annual collection that our missions ministry team does each and every year. To help support a ministry of the Cumberland Presbyterian Church outside of the United States. And this year, and all the proceeds that we receive from the loaves and fishes offering will be used to help support Venezuelan refugee children and their after-school programs. We have, in Central America, we have and in South America, we have Cumberland Presbyterian missions and ministries that are caring for young folks and making sure that they have everything that they need. And so this year it'll be the Venezuelan refugee children after school program that we will be supporting. So you can take these with you and keep them. We will receive this collection back in the Sunday of Thanksgiving, the Sunday before Thanksgiving in November is when this collection is due back. So just take one of those with you and put change in it. Or if you're not a change person anymore, if you just wanted to write a check to the missions ministry team or to the church, we would take that and make sure that they get that. Also, next weekend, I will be out of the pulpit next Sunday. I will be working at the Grace Presbytery Fall Youth Retreat, which will be in Mississippi. Our good friend Jim Truesdale will be here next Sunday leading in the Word. And so Jim is a faithful friend of mine, and he's a faithful friend of the church. And I'm always blessed to have him be able to come in and share the Word of God with you when I'm away. So that will be taking place next Sunday. With that said, I want to invite Miss Melissa, if you would, to come forward and lead all of us children this morning in the children's message.
Good morning. Brady's getting on. I hear it. We all are. So this week I was reading something, and it said, it was from a therapist, it was an article in a magazine, and the therapist said that the majority of the things that she treats people for, talks to them about, would have been avoided had people had some kindness. And that really struck me. I thought, okay, that's a lot. You know, that if people are lashing out, if they had just been kind, all of that would have been avoided. So think about a moment this week with someone kind to you this week. Can you think about it? What was the moment? Did somebody say something nice to you? Did somebody do something for you? That was somebody complimented your husband? Did y'all do something kind for somebody else? Yes. What did you do this week that was kind?
I didn't. I got a call from Ms. Van Glass wishing that, hoping that we're doing well. And that was a really nice conversation to have.
So those moments of kindness are special, and they kind of keep us going. So here's our verse. It's Ephesians 4:32. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. So just that small thing, very small, kind gestures, sending a birthday card, calling a friend, talking to someone, giving someone some paper at school, even they don't have any paper, you hand it to them. That's a small thing. It's kind. But those little small moments mean a lot. So let's pray about that. Dear Lord, thank you for giving us kindness. Help us remember to give it to others. Amen.
I want to invite everyone to stand as we're called to worship this morning from Philippians chapter 1. Melissa talked about kindness, and the letter of Paul to Philippians is a letter that is filled with kindness. You see the dynamic of the Philippian church and the love that they had for Paul and the love that he had for them. And so we're able to see that one of those foundations of our faith is just that kindness of brotherly love, of caring for one another. And so as we gather this morning for worship, let us remember those things as we begin worship. Paul writes, our prayer is that our love may abound more and more, so that we may approve what is excellent, and we may be pure and blameless for the day of Christ. Will you join me as we go together and open this service with prayer? O God, you are rich in love for your people. Show us the treasure that endures, and when we are tempted by greed, remind us of your lavish mercy. Call us back into your service, and make us worthy to be entrusted with the wealth that never fails. We ask this through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We begin worship this morning by singing of hymn number 3, verses 1, 3, and 4 of Holy, Holy, Holy.
Thank you.
with us and has had towards us. We remember how he has called us, how he's given us life, how he's given us hope, how he's given us a place in his family. Our baptism is a reminder of that work of God in our lives. It is something that we should celebrate and we should think about often. We should think about how, in some point in our lives, either we ourselves presented ourselves to be baptized or our parents presented us to be baptized. But in that presentation, there's this faith that speaks into that act. And it's a faith that relies upon Christ and for what he has done for us. And so let us give God thanks for our baptism today. Let us give God thanks for how he has placed us into a family of faith. And give God thanks for the hope that he gives us in Jesus Christ. Eternal and gracious God, we give you thanks. In countless ways you have revealed yourself in ages past and have blessed us with signs of your grace. We praise you that through the waters of the sea you led your people Israel out of bondage into freedom and the land of your promise. We praise you for sending Jesus your Son, who for us was baptized in the waters of the Jordan and was anointed as the Christ by your Holy Spirit. Through the baptism of his death and resurrection, you set us free from the bondage of sin and death and give us cleansing and rebirth. We praise you that in baptism you give us your Holy Spirit, who teaches us and leads us into all truth, filling us with a variety of gifts that we might proclaim the gospel to all nations and serve you as a royal priesthood. Amen. The prophet Isaiah reminds us, when we pass through deep waters or go through times of fiery trial, the Lord our God is with us. With confidence in God, our Creator and Redeemer, let us confess our sin this day, first silently, and then together with our prayer of confession. Let us pray. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us now pray together. Almighty and merciful God, we have erred and strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against your holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done. O Lord, have mercy upon us. Spare those who confess their faults. Restore those who are penitent, according to your promises declared to the world in Jesus Christ our Lord. And grant, O merciful God, for his sake, that we may live a holy, just, and humble life to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Friends, do not fear, says the Lord, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. Brothers and sisters, believe the gospel. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Amen. Forgiven, let us now stand and continue in worship as we sing hymn number 581, verses 1 and 4 of 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus.
Thank you.
Our scripture reading comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 1 through 23. Friends, I want to invite you this day to listen carefully, for this is God's word. Paul writes, "But I, brothers and sisters, could not address you as spiritual people, but as people of the flesh, as infants in Christ. I fed you with milk, not solid food, for you are not ready for it. And even now you are not yet ready, for you are still of the flesh. For while there is jealousy and strife among you, you are not of the flesh and behaving only in a human way. For when one says, 'I follow Paul,' and another, 'I follow Apollos,' are you not being merely human? What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you believe, as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. He who plants and he who waters are one, and each will receive his wages according to his labor, for we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, God's building. According to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, and someone else is building upon it. Let each one take care how he builds upon it. For no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become manifest. For the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. If the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, though he himself will be saved, but only as through fire. Do you not know that you are God's temple, and that God's Spirit dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him, for God's temple is holy, and you are that temple. Let no one deceive himself. If anyone among you thinks that he is wise in this age, let him become a fool that he may become wise. For the wisdom of this world is folly with God. For it is written, he catches the wise in their craftiness. And again, the Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, that they are futile. So let no one boast in men, for all things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas or the world or life or death or the present or the future. All are yours, and you are Christ's, and Christ is God's. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
heard people say being a Christian is easy. All you have to do is love God and love people. But I like to try to blow that up and try to say it's not as easy as just saying those words, right? When I hear people say that, I tend to think, well, you obviously don't know who God is, and you obviously don't know a whole lot of people. Because we all have in our lives people that it is hard to love. We all have individuals in our lives that create a challenge for us to love them and to be around them. The challenge of loving God, though, comes when we are supposed to love people. God tells us that for those who love Him, they will obey His word and they will do His commands. God tells us that we are to love one another, everyone who's friendly towards us. But Jesus doesn't stop there. Jesus says you're to love your enemies as well. And if we have a hard time loving our friends, which we all have friends that sometimes it's hard to love them, but we certainly have people in our lives that we would call enemies, and we know how hard it is to love them. Those two commands of loving God and loving people are linked together. If we don't love people, then do we truly love God? Because we do know that Jesus tells us that if you love me, obey my commands. Do these things that I've shared with you to do. It's a challenge. It's a challenge to live out the Christian life. It's not an impossible challenge, though. It is, though challenging, it is what defines us. So even though it could be hard to love God and to love people, it doesn't mean that we give up and that we ignore that. No, we run wholeheartedly into that challenge. And we kind of live our lives in the type of way that Jacob in Genesis, or that fun fellow Jacob in Genesis, who we know stole his brother's birthright, but then had that wrestling match with God overnight. No, the challenge of being a Christian, of loving God and loving others, we have to approach it much like Jacob approached that wrestling match with God. If you remember the story, it goes something like this. They wrestle all night, and God is like, let me go, Jacob. And Jacob responds, I will not let you go until you bless me. That blessing came in the form of a dislocated hip, and I'm sure Jacob limped for the rest of his life. But it was a blessing nevertheless. And it was something that he engaged in with God. The challenge of wrestling with God, the challenge of loving God, the challenge of loving people is something that we are to embrace wholeheartedly, even if it does leave us with a limp in our lives. Over the last few weeks, we've begun going through the book of 1 Corinthians, and Corinthians is a challenging letter because there's a lot of stuff going on in this church community. But Paul begins this letter by trying to get the people of God in that church community all on the same page. If you have ever been a boss, a manager, a supervisor, the leader of a team, a coach, a Sunday school teacher, if you've ever done anything that requires leadership, where you are going to be leading a group of people, you understand how difficult and how challenging that can be of getting people who are from different times, from different locations, from different experiences, to get them all on the same page. We all know that there's a challenge with that. I have that challenge oftentimes, not only with athletics, with the boys, coaching them, but in my work with the presbytery, in my work with the denomination. It can be very difficult when you bring a group of people together who have their own thoughts, their own ideas, their own motivations, their own personalities, the ways that they think work should be done, and trying to bring people together under one umbrella to say, hey guys, we've got to work together. Even if, when we're working together, there's somebody that's on our team we don't particularly care for, or we don't particularly agree with. Paul is having this discussion with the Christians in Corinth, trying to get them all on the same page. As a community of saved people, as a community of Christians, as a community of people who have been given the message of the gospel to go and preach and proclaim, that message, it didn't erase all of the challenges that is within that community. And over the last few weeks, we've kind of navigated a little bit through what some of those challenges are. As you go through the book of Corinthians, you see that there are even deeper challenges that the community faces. But it all boils down to, you have individuals who are sinners. They are flawed. They're compromised. They're different. Some of them are rich, others are poor. Some of them are Jewish, others are Gentiles. There's all kinds of things that are kind of stacked against them. These hurdles that they have to jump over about how they are to live their lives together. And the one way in which they seem to be trying to overcome their differences is by looking at their leaders themselves. Sometimes a strong leader can bring about unity for a team. We look at athletic competitions, and you can look at a football team, and there's 80 some odd players on a football team, and those 80 people are very, very different. None of them are the same. They all have things that make them unique. And if you've got a good, strong leader, a good, strong coach, that coach, with his own strength, can bring about some sense of unity, some sense of desire and shared purpose. But we know that sense of unity and that shared purpose can only last so long if it's based in that one human being, because we all know that leaders will leave. We look at team sports, and you see it concentrated so much. Coaches will leave. So what happens to that team when that coach leaves? If that leader is who has been unifying them, what happens when that staple is removed and the unique pages begin to disperse? Paul has this conflict going on in Corinth, where the people are trying to establish the unity of the church on the personalities of their leaders. Which is why this constant argument keeps coming up in the first three chapters. Paul trying to get people out of the mindset of looking at their leaders for being their unity, for being their one point. Because even with them looking at their leaders, you see that with the different leaders that are in the church, Peter, Paul, Apollos, that even those leaders are actually causing, not them themselves doing this, but the people as they follow these leaders are being disunified. They are experiencing separation because there are groups in the church who really, really like Apollos and they don't care much for Paul. There are some in that church that don't really care much for Peter, but they really, really love Paul. And so it's causing tension within the church. And Paul's main argument at the beginning of Corinthians and his task at the beginning of Corinthians is to get that perspective out of their minds. This group of diverse people from different backgrounds, from different upbringings, from different cultures, from different ways of life, from different thoughts about how life should be lived, to get them out of that perspective of trying to align themselves with human influences and to focus upon what the true foundation is, which is why Paul has spent a lot of time talking about Jesus Christ and being in Christ and about Jesus being the foundation for their entire life together. Which leads us to this place in our own lives where we look at where we're from. When we look at the church, today is Worldwide Communion Sunday. And Worldwide Communion Sunday is a day on the church calendar that is across denominations. And it is meant to be a show of churches around the world, even though we don't all congregate together at the same time or in the same location. But it is this attempt that we have for us as the people of God to know that all of the Christian faiths, be they whatever denomination that they are in their heart and essence one. And so when we take communion today, we are taking communion not only remembering the benefits and the grace that God has given us in Jesus Christ, but we're also being mindful that there are churches in our neighborhood and in our state, in our denomination and in other denominations who we may not get along with, who we may not know, but we are still one regardless. And we share this meal together, not just with us in this room, but with all the churches around the world. All the churches that proclaim Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior of their lives. Jesus is that unity. He is that demonstration of God's love for us. And Paul, as he is leading the people of Corinth into this way, he is continually having to get them to understand that they are works in progress. Which is why it begins the very beginning here. As he talks to the people, he's not talking to the people of the church in a derogatory way. He's not looking down upon them. He's just sharing them with them the truth. That as they have been reborn by Jesus Christ, through Jesus Christ, as they have been born again, just as you were once born and were an infant and you needed help growing, you needed help feeding yourself, you needed help cleaning yourself, you needed help in understanding what this world is all about. But that's the way it works too spiritually for us as believers. We don't just proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and all of our problems melt away. That doesn't happen. We don't proclaim Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, and all things that we don't understand or don't know, those things don't just come to us automatically. It's not a magic trick. It's a way of life. It's a way of us learning. It's a way of us being filled and growing in this faith and in this life that we live. And we see that in this community that there are things that are afflicting the believers in Corinth. Paul is specific, and in verse 3, he talks about how there's jealousy within the church, how there's strife within the church. The strife is probably linked to the jealousy, because you're looking at people who, again, come from different backgrounds. They're looking at their own lives, and then they see the life of someone else, and they may yearn for their life instead of being thankful to God for the life that they have. We have a demonstration of this in our own life, and it is called social media, right? When you look at Facebook or Instagram or whatever social networking networks that there are, one of the big flaws to all this is the jealousy that it breeds within our lives. I've never really seen a Facebook profile or page where people put the reality of their life out there. It's always something better looking. It's always the successes. It's much like a resume, right? Where we don't put our failures or the things that we're ashamed of out there, we put ourselves in the best light. And there can be this thing that happens when you're absorbing social media where you start looking at the lives of others and you begin to yearn for that life. Instead of understanding that thing that we look at, social media, is largely a fake world. It's not reality. Because we all know people have struggles. People all have tribulations. When we look into the lives of others, if there's great successes in their lives, it's not just because somebody just threw it at them or they just opened up a present one day and boom, they're successful. It came after hard work a lot of times. Where people had to grow and people had to achieve and get what they've gotten through hard work. We don't see that necessarily. The only thing that we see is they have that, why don't I have it? That's a root that's going on in the church in Corinth. Though they didn't have social media, they had each other, they had their lives, they knew where each other were from. And you had those in the community who were jealous. And anytime somebody's jealous, anytime that there's strife, there's often this doubling down that happens to try to make yourself feel better, look better, or be better. And that's where this focus on people saying, well, I follow Apollos, or I follow Paul, or I follow Peter, comes up. It's this point where people are trying to make themselves look better, sound better, and appear better to other folks. And it's actually causing friction and difficulty within the church. And so Paul is having to get the perspectives right by sharing with them the reality of who they are. Which is why Paul will always be one of these guys that, though if you have your own opinions about him, Paul is a humble guy. He will share that he has weaknesses. He will share openly that he's not a really good speaker. And he shares that with the Corinthians. He tells them, when I came to you, I didn't come to you in boldness and in a bunch of smart words. I came to you in weakness. I came to you with what some would call foolish words. To share with you about the reality of who we are. And where Paul leads them in beginning in verse 5 is he asks just point blank the question about the thing that is causing division within the church. These individuals who are valuing these humans over the foundation who is Jesus. And Paul has to change their perspective on them. What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Simply put, they're servants. Servants who are working together. Working together for a common cause. Working together with a common message. With a message that transcends who they are as people. Remember, Paul was a guy who was not always a Christian in his life. He was a guy who actually persecuted and attended deaths of Christians. He wanted the church of God to be destroyed. At least the church of Jesus Christ destroyed. He wanted it destroyed, and in Acts we know that it was a pretty passionate thing for him because the word is used that he was breathing murder against the church of Jesus Christ. But here he is, as a leader in the church of Jesus Christ, as somebody who had been born again himself, trying to help individuals understand who they are and their place in the church, and to not get sidetracked by all of the flash of all of the leaders, but instead to focus on the foundation. And that focus on the foundation is that we as the people of God are proclaiming that one message of Jesus Christ. And there's not one of us who is more valuable than the next. We are all working together symbiotically. We are all working together to be servants of the Lord. There is no competition between Apollos and Paul and Peter. They're just doing the work that's been assigned to them. And as they do their work, it is not them who is creating the moment and creating the whole church, but it is God Himself who is at the center of that work. It is actually God Himself who is inspiring and causing the growth within the church. And it is that perspective as we live our lives where we have to understand that is why we are here. Not for our own motivations, not for our own successes, our individual motives or agendas. Which we know the church can be filled with individuals who have their own ways of doing things. Paul is leading and encouraging the people of Corinth to walk in humble and humility. To walk with a perspective and an understanding about who they really are. And that's and their servants. Each has their own place. I spend a lot of time remembering my childhood each and every week, because I really am grateful for the childhood that I had. I'm really grateful for the experiences that I had working with my grandfather and seeing how a house starts as nothing but a concrete slab and watching that house get put together. And what I thought about over this last week was that there wasn't just one or two guys who built the entire house from start to finish. No, there were people who that was their job to do. You had the folks that came out and they would do the plumbing work. Then you had the guys that would pour the foundation work. And then you had the carpenters who would come and put up the wooden studs and get the house framed all up. Then you had electricians come in and they did their work. You had heating and air people who came in and did their work. Then you had where we came in, the drywall people, hanging the drywall. And you know what? Even my grandfather, the guys who hung the sheetrock weren't the same ones who finished it. There was different guys that did that. When we got finished with our job, you had the painters who came in. You had the cabinet guys who came in. All of these guys had their own talents, their own skills. And at the end of the process, you had what began as a vacant lot, and you saw how a house was built. And it wasn't because there was just one person there doing all of that work. It was a team effort. It was the effort of people who may or may not have known each other. I didn't know many concrete people. I knew a lot of painters, but I didn't know a lot of concrete people. But I knew that they were there because the work had been done. And so as we live our lives, as I live my life, I sit and I look for those opportunities and those perspectives. And I think that's what the church needs to be focused upon each and every time it gets together. And we're not looking at each other and being frustrated at each other, though there could be occasions for that. Or looking at each other and thinking, man, that person really isn't a valuable part of the people of God. We all have a role to play. We all have a job to do. We all have a place in order to be obedient to God and to serve God, to love God. And the house that is built should be one where we are encountering those challenges of life, not pointing fingers of blame or causing people to feel less, but for us to all see that we all have that place where the work of God can be done. Paul wants us, he wants the Corinthians, and he wants us to always be mindful of that word, of that role, of who we are. And even when we find ourselves in places where we may not all agree, or we may not all have the same type of goals, at the end of the day, those perspectives should bring us together, not divide us. We should all have this vision of our work, of the service that we are doing, to build a house, to continue to build upon a foundation that was laid so long ago, to see life, to see ministry, to see folks living not as defeated Christians in the world, but as lively Christians and part of a family together. That is who we are. We are God's temple. And as we work together as this temple, we are to be pursuing those things that are holy, those things that would make us obedient to him, which is why Paul closes there in verse 21, where he says, with that in mind, the perspective is not you as an individual, not us as individuals, but us as a family. Let no one boast in men. For all things are ours. All things belong to us. when we are in this place, within this family, within this body. Because it's not us doing work on our own. It is us serving Christ together so that Christ will do his work in our communities, in our lives, in our families, wherever it is that we are. Friends, may we go forth with this reality. May we go forth with this purpose to the glory of our God. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends, let us affirm the faith of our baptism this morning in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Will you join me as we go now into a time of prayer? I want to invite you to look at the prayer list and remember all the names that are listed there. Know that each and every one of our brothers and sisters who have been added to our prayer list have been added because we love them. And we are hopeful that the Lord would give comfort and grace to each one and whatever that they need. Will you join me as we go to the Lord in this time? Mighty God, we do thank you for calling us into this family of faith under the Lordship of Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, for calling us to serve you, for calling us to serve one another. And we ask, Lord God, that as we ponder what our perspectives are, that, Lord, that we would not look at differences, but instead, Lord, that we would find those opportunities and the reasons why you have called us to be together. There are great opportunities, Lord, that we all have before us to share your love with those who are in desperate need of hearing about your love. So God, help us, lead us, and guide us as we continue to build upon that foundation who is Jesus Christ. God, as we have lifted up to you those who are on our prayer list and those that we have brought in who we've not named, but they are upon our hearts, we do pray that, God, that you would give life and blessing to those who are in need. God, give safety to those who are traveling. God, give healing to those who are sick. Give discernment, Lord, to those who are searching. And God, give confidence to those who doubt. Lord, we thank you for the ministry that you have called us to. And I ask, Lord God, that we would continually be faithful in doing what you have called us to do, which is to share the good news. Lord, we love you, we thank you, and we ask all this in the name of Jesus, who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I want to invite you to look at the insert that is in your worship guide as we prepare to celebrate the Lord's Supper. Each and every time we celebrate the Lord's Supper, I want to make sure everyone knows that this table does not belong to this church. It is the Lord's table. And so all who confess Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior are invited to take of this meal and to take of it joyfully. When it comes time for you to come forward, we will be celebrating communion by intinction, meaning that you will come forward at the appropriate time. You'll take a piece of bread and you will dip it into the cup, and then you will eat and then return to your seat. I'm going to ask that the choir If you would come first, if everyone, once we get to that spot, the choir, if you would come first and you would be served, and then everyone else would come forward. And then if you are unable to come forward, I will come to you. So at the very end, if you have not come forward, I will keep my watchful eye across the room. And if you do not come forward, I will bring the elements to you so that you can be included in this as well. Let us now worship the Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise, O Lord our God, creator and ruler of the universe. In your wisdom, you made all things and sustained them by your power. You formed us in your image, setting us in this world to love and to serve you, and to live in peace with your whole creation. When we rebelled against you, refusing to trust and obey you, you did not reject us, but you still claimed us as your own. You sent prophets to call us back to your way. Then, in the fullness of time, out of your great love for the world, you sent your only Son to be one of us, to redeem us and heal our brokenness. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with the choirs of angels, with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all the faithful of every time and place who forever sing to the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are holy, O God of majesty, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. In Jesus, born of Mary, your word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. He lived as one of us, knowing joy and sorrow. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, opened blind eyes, broke bread with outcasts and sinners, and proclaimed the good news of your kingdom to the poor and needy. Dying on the cross, he gave himself for the life of the world. Rising from the grave, he won for us victory over death. Seated at your right hand, he leads us to eternal life. We praise you that Christ now reigns with you in glory and will come again to make all things new. Remembering your gracious acts in Jesus Christ, we take from your creation this bread and this wine and joyfully celebrate his dying and rising as we await the day of his coming. With thanksgiving, we offer you our very selves to you to be a living and holy sacrifice dedicated to your service. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, that we may be one with all who share this feast, united in ministry in every place. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. In union with your church in heaven and on earth, we pray, O God, that you will fulfill your eternal purpose in us and in all the world. Keep us faithful in your service until Christ comes in final victory, and we shall feast with all your saints in the joy of your eternal realm. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. I want to invite the choir, if you would get now, make your way forward. And once they are finished, I invite everyone to come whenever you feel best to come and taste and see that the Lord is good. Almighty God, you provide the true bread from heaven, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant that we who have received the sacrament of his body and blood may abide in him and he in us, that we may be filled with the power of his endless life, now and forever. Amen. Amen. This morning is hymn number 368, verses 1 and 3 of He Lives.
Thank you.
benediction. He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. Friends, go now in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.